Hi to everybody. I was mistaken. I thought that the talk was at 1 because I was so easy close to the time. I was about to sit a bit, but it turns out that this is the time. So glad to be here. Very thankful both to the Center for Jewish and Israeli Studies and to the Department of Economics for bringing me over. It has been so far a wonderful visit. And you know, there's a danger when you have a good visit because it may repeat itself in the future. So we live with that. So what I intend to do today is to present to you a particular view of the Israeli economy that stems from the title, you know, the Great Economic Paradox, which is this: the fact that we have a great economy on the one hand, at the macro level, but on the other hand, we have a great deal of discontent. So that's kind of what drives this presentation. And to my colleagues here, I will say, you know, this is not what we call a paper in the classic sense, but rather a presentation for a more general public. So what we have is, as I said, these two phenomena that typically don't go together. Although it's not that rare, you don't expect to be side by side, and certainly not over a long period of time. We have had this strong, steady macroeconomic performance for more than a decade, you know, going back to the 2003 or something like that, but even before there was a good economic performance, and at the same time this growing social discontent that exploded in 2011 and has not gone away, okay? So the question, I'm going first to present the data to try to convince you that indeed we have the great economic performance on the one hand and the sources of social discontent on the other, and then ask, you know, what may account for this two-pronged phenomena, and maybe if we have time, I will discuss briefly whether this is sustainable, whether this is something that we can keep going along the same route over time. So the good news, you know, it's always better to start with the good news, then we can sort of change the angle. I will look at data regarding macroeconomic performance, meaning growth, and the fiscal aspect, the labor market, trade, the financial sector. Okay, we look at each one of them and look at the figures and the trends to get an impression of this first part of great macroeconomic performance. So the OECD, as you know, the OECD is this club of now 35 or 36 countries, I can't remember exactly, because it keeps changing, that qualify to be members of this club. These are generally the developed countries, but there are also countries from Latin America. Mexico is there, and Chile is there, but for the most part it's the European, Western European countries, plus others. Israel became a member of the OECD some 10 years ago. You have to qualify for it, okay? And it's good because it serves as a yardstick, as a source of comparison. Where do you stand vis-a-vis these countries? Every year they come to Israel, delegation, they investigate around, they gather data and so forth, and they come up with a report. And that report has turned into an important source of information for policymakers and so forth. Where do we stand vis-a-vis others, okay? And they published this report just recently, last month. So this is the most recent data. So we are going to look at both the first part, the first panel, the growth of the economy, and the part of the debt. So let's zoom in. So starting in 2000, okay, we see the red line is the growth of real GDP, the national product of Israel. The green line is the growth of the OECD countries, the average of them. The dotted lines are the per capita, okay? And so again, the red is Israel, the green is the OECD countries. So we can see that, except for the early 2000s, and we're going to see why, Here, Israel was doing worse than the average for the OECD. But then, what's important here is the slope change, and we have not stopped ever since, with small dips here and here, and we're going to explore why. But other than that, we took off, and so the economy, in real terms, grew by a factor of 75% cumulative vis-a-vis the starting point here, whereas the OECD countries fare much less well, and you see the gap that opened. This is not, this is starting from the same point here, right? 100, and then you look at the cumulative change. In per capita terms, we have been doing better, but the gap is less so for one reason. The growth of population, in Israel, population is growing much faster, and therefore when you divide by the growing population, the performance is less good, but nevertheless, okay? And, you know, for us economists, if we are asked, like Hillel, you know, turn all your wisdom in standing on one foot, you will say, look at this graph, because it got growth over long periods of time embodies the many, many phenomena in the economy. If you're not doing well, okay, it's going to be reflected here. You see, you have to do well in many respects for growth to keep going, okay? So that's kind of, it's a reflection of the underlying health of the Israeli economy. This is the debt of the country divided by GDP. This is a very important measure, particularly when you look at the time series, how the country is doing in terms of its indebtedness, capacity to repay the debt, so it's relative to the GDP. It's a measure of risk and so forth, and it's a measure of, when you look at it over time, of behavior, because if you keep accumulating debt over time relative to the GDP, you are doing something wrong in terms of deficits and so forth and so on. So it's a good measure of behavior vis-a-vis your capacity to pay. What do we see? Well, we were in very bad shape here, okay? And, you know, we had debt to GDP more than 90%. That was considered at the time really off the chart. It was only one country, but it was one country in the civilized world that was doing worse, which is Japan, but that's a different story. That in a way, they can afford to do worse. We can, and given the risks of being in a bad neighborhood, we are in the Middle East, this takes particular significance, more than in other places. So, for us, dropping, okay, what became an essential target of policy, and indeed it happened, you see. And then we hit this time at the time of the crisis, the world crisis, when it erupts in 2008. And then what happens is that most of the other countries, debt takes off because they were badly hit by the global crisis, okay? Including the U.S. You know, the U.S., the debt to GDP ratio of the U.S. Since then, Martin, you can tell me, when in the past it was like that, I don't remember.
You'd have to go back to World War II.
World War II, that's what they were thinking. So it's really, you know, exceptionally bad, okay? And you see, as it keep growing, it's more than 100%, whereas ours has kept declining except for this blip in 2009. So this is really an amazing economic achievement of Israel. You know, we are hitting the 60% mark has been sort of this target that in Europe became a big thing because of the Maastricht agreements or the Maastricht covenant or whatever you may want to call it. It became sort of the place you want to be in or below, but so it's something to aspire to. We are very close to that target. Believe me, when you know I was in government here in 2006 to 2009, and we were pursuing that, we were not convinced that we will be able to get there. And indeed, you know, it has happened. Now, in terms of distilling it further into episodes, if we go back to 1980, this is 1980 to 85, the worst crisis that the Israeli economy went through. the hyperinflation. I want to say the following. Hyperinflation is one of the worst economic diseases that you can imagine. It's so destructive of institutions, of the faith in the system. It creates, it brings about redistribution of wealth between groups of people, debtors and creditors and so forth, in a way that does not reflect at all the values that you push forward and so forth. So it's a really, and it's also a symptom, it's one of the most critical symptoms of a government or government policy go awry. I mean, it's just, you know, you're out of control, essentially. Okay, it's like being on drugs. Okay, but you're really, unless, be careful, unless it's sort of provoked by some sort of collapse that it's not, you're not responsible for. So some of the hyperinflation in Europe following First World War was due to the stupidity of the Allies, okay, that imposed, you know, impossible conditions, particularly on Austria and so forth. And so the hyperinflation was not really the product of pure stupidity or political, you know, political wrong, but rather from, but this, we don't have that excuse. And this is also, from my point of view, it's a stain on the history of Israel, you know, but in any case, it serves a good purpose in retrospect, because the trauma of that hyperinflation lasts to this day and has been guiding much more responsible policies since, okay? So you see that growth takes off after the hyperinflation in 1985. The government put together a really comprehensive economic plan, both to overcome the hyperinflation and to open up the economy. I'm going to comment on that further. And then we have this big shock here, which is the conjunction of two forces. You know, the burst of the high-tech bubble, many of you may remember, this is actually not just in Israel, it happened all over the place, .com bubble, okay, that was really kind of a crash. It was a mini crash, it didn't never got to affect the whole economy, but it was very significant. For Israel, it was a macro event, because the economy has become driven so much by the high-tech sector that the explosion of the bubble created the macroeconomic repercussions, not so much in other countries that were much less dependent upon high tech. Okay? And the second force was the second intifada that exploded starting in full force in 2001, started before. We had both. And that, you know, created had a very profound impact on the economy, but luckily the economy has been recovering from this disease of the early 1980s, and so it was more resilient, and that together with a reaction on the part of policy that was very determined managed us to pull out from that, and really remarkable come about. And the only other small bit, you know, it looks big here, but you have to understand that having above zero growth in 2009 was an amazing achievement, even if it was 0 point something, okay? So at the time I was in government, and, you know, there are questions I can tell you about the management of the crisis, that was really quite remarkable. We were very lucky to have at the helm of the central bank in Israel, Stan Fischer, that really was the we say in Hebrew, the Bugar Achai, the responsible adult, okay, that was
the grown up
that was really giving confidence and experience into play in the management of the crisis. And we are doing very well since. Now, the labor market. The labor market, again, is one of the key indicators of how well the economy is doing. It's not exactly the same as reflecting the same thing as growth. You can have weird combinations in that respect, but it's incredibly important. Unemployment. So unemployment kept rising throughout the second half of the 1990s and, of course, during the crisis of the early 2000s with the explosion of the bubble. And, but since then, and except for during the blip in 2009, has come down like a rock. And we, now we hit bottom at 3.6% of unemployment, which is a historical low record. And it's a record for us, and it's a worldwide, it's a very, very low rate of unemployment, correctly measured, because the rate of unemployment is tricky, how you measure it, and it's really remarkable. Now, what accounts for the massive immigration from the former Soviet Union play a role in bringing up the unemployment rate, because there were a mass of people kind of entering the labor market, willing to work, not finding employment right away. That was one of the forces, not the only one. And of course, we have the burst of the high tech and the bubble, and then the world crisis there, but okay. So this is remarkable in itself. What's more remarkable, and that's really, it's not unique, but it's rare, is this, that at the same time that the employment was dropping like a rock, the participation rate was increasing. Why is that unusual? Because typically when you have a sharp increase in participation rate, meaning more and more people enter the labor force, some of them, many of them for the first time, they don't find work right away. So they simultaneously increase the participation rate and the unemployment rate. Okay, so you have the trends go together oftentimes and not like a scissors. Okay, so this scissor, okay, is really particular when it's prolonged. Okay, the prolonged trend of increasing participation rate and in the decrease in unemployment is something which is really an amazing feat of in terms of the economics, the functioning of the economy. And there is a lot of work being done, you know, investigating, you know, how can you account for these, you know, trends? And of course, the net result is this employment rate that has been shooting up, okay, which is essentially you take out from the those that want to work, those that don't work, you get those that actually work as a percentage of the those that could work, okay, in terms of age and so forth, and you get the participation rate. So this is a remarkable picture. I mean, that part of it, okay, this chunk of it is really remarkable, okay, and still we don't understand entirely, okay, what accounts for that. There are, of course, there is work being done to unveil that. Now, I want to show you this graph. Yes.
I'm curious. How much of the increase in participation, because it could be females,
yeah,
with massively religious people, or
okay,
Israelis.
So let me show you this graph, and then that will answer a little bit of that, not entirely. I want to show you this graph because I think this is one of the facts that should be known about Israel, that because Israel is unique in the world in what I'm going to show. So this is the fertility rate, meaning the number of the average number of children per woman in the relative ages, okay? And this is the labor force participation rate of women. And these are the OECD countries plus some others. Okay, it's not just OECD. You see Brazil, Colombia, etc. Okay? Now, the average for the OECD is 1.7, the fertility rate, much lower than the rate that is considered to be necessary for maintaining a stable population, which is 2.1. By the way, there are questions about the 2.1, you know, it's not clear with the 1, but no, because things have changed in terms of medicine and so forth, and survival.
Not all the women are married.
Not all the women are married, that's one of the things, but not all the not all the women that have children are married, and so, you know, it's very interesting. It's an interesting thing. I mean, and you can see how countries are really concentrated around in a band around this 1.7. Mexico is relatively right with more than 2, okay, but that's an exception. And in terms of participation rates of women, there's a wide discrepancy. You can see here the Mediterranean countries in Southern Europe, or the coincidence, countries with crisis and so forth. Okay, you can see up there, of course, the Nordic countries, okay? So it's what you expect, more or less. Where is Israel? Okay? So it's really stunning. I really paid a lot of attention to this piece of data because it's unique. There's no other country in the world that has that combination. As I said before, a fertility rate of 3.1 and a very high participation rate. Okay, so you may say, well, this is due to the ultra-Orthodox, not quite. There you have the answer. So this is the Jewish women, non-Haredi, the fertility, so no Arabs, no. So still, the fertility rate, 2.75, okay? And the labor force participation, one of the highest in the OECD. So this is
Arabs, Arab women?
No, so it's Jewish, no. Non-Haredi. Jewish, so non-Arab, okay? So the 2.75 is my goal.
My goal.
We're not there yet.
Yeah. No, they will come.
That will come. So this is what you have, okay? Now, what's stunning is not the 2.75. The 2.75 and 81.9% in labor force participation. So the typical Israeli woman, young people, they have children, they work, and they work in significant careers, okay? Now, this has incredibly wide-range implications for the economy, for well-being, for the tensions and pressures that they are subjected to, and so forth and so on. So, and it's a very mixed picture, let me tell you, okay, because it's very hard to sustain that data point there. Okay? Yes.
Do you know the women that you're referring to, do they have partners and are they also working?
Right. So this is the typical is a two. First of all, the rate of unmarried mothers in Israel is low. It exists, it's a category, it's, you know, there are sorts of considerations in the law trying to help them, but it's relatively small. And the typical is the couple, both of them work, okay? Both of them, it's not in equal parts, but, you know, participating in both, bringing the income to the household. Mm-hmm.
But there is significant partnerships for
women. I'm going to talk about that in a moment when we see anticipating that. So, but this is the picture, okay?
And well, I suppose about that dot there.
Which dot?
Below Israel.
Ah, yeah. This is this one.
Yeah.
Yeah. This one is Israel 5 years ago or something like that. So I don't remember exactly. Actually, I should have put it explicitly because that will lead to the previous graph showing the increase in labor force participation. Okay, what happened is that, we'll see that later, but many Haredi women, ultra-Orthodox women, entered the labor market. Arab women, less, but still, nevertheless, there is an upper trend. And as Yossi said, also part-time women that were not working previously entered. Okay, so you have a jump in labor force participation. But I don't remember when it's 5 years ago, I don't remember exactly when. We can go back to the
graph. That's the other graph.
Yeah. Okay.
There was also a change in the method of the
counting, yes, right. But the method of collecting statistics was affected mostly the unemployment rate. It was a break and less the participation rate. Now, so we have seen the two initial good news. Then we have the trade balance. I'm not going to dwell on it much unless there are questions, but we have seen something that if you would have asked an Israeli 30 years ago whether we would ever have a surplus in the balance of payment, they would say, sure, when the Messiah comes. I can assure you that the Messiah has not come, but we have a surplus. And
some of those mothers. Okay? Ask some of the mothers.
Right. And we had the balance of trade surplus for all over a decade. We have a diversified export market that's very important, because we know that there's a shift in the locus, or loss of trade in the world, you know, towards the east. We were very much focused on the US and Europe. We are part of the European market, okay? And with trade advantages and so forth. So there was a big concern about, you know, being sidelined by the shift to China. But no, we have entered into strong commercial links with China and with India. Much more with Vietnam and other countries, but it's happening. So now the distribution is much more less risky than it used to be. And we have accumulated the foreign reserve to the tune of $113 billion. Stan Fisher started with that policy of supporting, essentially not letting the shekel appreciate too much, because, you know, that has repercussions for export and so forth. This has been a big controversial, but nevertheless, we're still pursuing that policy, less aggressively now, but nevertheless, we have accumulated that much. I didn't bring the figure of the ratio of reserves to GDP, but it's high by international comparison, okay? So this is also...
It's about 40%. I know, just a slightly different perspective on that trade balance. I mean, the flip side of that, of course, is means that investments are flowing abroad, not into Israel. I don't know. You know, that's another way of looking at it, and I might have thought you'd want to see investments flowing the other way. I don't know.
On net, I mean, there are investments flowing both ways. Okay, big time.
Of course.
Mm-hmm. Okay, both. So it's not the one-sided thing.
Yeah.
Okay, but the more.
So Israelis are investing abroad.
Also,
is the flip side of that.
It's the flip side of that, and also there is a question about the benefits of this. Increased expansion in trade, is it generalized in this economy, society, or is it concentrated that we're going to talk about? Okay, because that's really it's important to understand the whole context.
It might be, but that's...
And then we have a financial sector that has proven to be very stable. You know, the crisis went by, didn't affect at all the banking system in Israel, very stable, very prudent, okay, with lots of mechanisms in place to avoid excessive borrowing. Even the type of debt that is being accumulated is controlled, for example, not too much to housing and so forth, to avoid, you know, if something happens to the housing market, to avoid affecting the banks. And so it's a very stable...
You also made a very good point. It's the benefit of the crisis of the 80s.
Ah, absolutely. I mean, we're going to see this in a moment when we ask the question, why? Okay, so lots of what we see is a good reaction to the trauma of the crisis. Traumas could play a very positive role. Okay, you manage it well. Okay, in economics is very true. Okay, and of course, you know, inflation. These days, when you talk to young people about inflation, they think you're talking about the ancient history. They don't understand what you're talking about, the concept. I'm serious. The students, right? Because, I mean, they don't understand the concept of inflation. For them, it's an abstract concept, okay? And in fact, we have been experiencing declines in the price level, negative inflation. One has to be careful not call it deflation, because that's a different thing, okay? And people are looking into it, and when a decline in prices, you know, may become threatening as a deflationary problem, etc. Very interesting that this is the sort of issues that are being discussed in Israel. Anyway, so now for the bad news, we spent too long with the good news. So when you look at the flip side of this, which is what happens in society, if you wish. High inequality, Gini coefficient of 0.37, may have gone down to 0.36, but nevertheless, it's very high. It's the fourth highest in the OECD. So Israel went from a country that was proud of being one of the most equal countries in terms of distribution of income to one of the most unequal countries, and that happened in the span of 30 years or so. Okay. The second is poverty. Poverty as measured conventionally, if how, what's the share of households below a household income of less than 50% of the median income. Okay? So we have, it has gone down a little bit from 19%, but it's still very high. It's the highest rate in the SDGs.
Is this poverty a measure of the entire population or of just that labor force? Because I'm just trying to sort of square it with
the entire population.
Okay.
And we will, in a moment, show a graph that speaks to that. Okay. This is the household income, all the households in the country. Okay. And this has been a source of concern in the last decade. How come that the minister didn't see that? Okay. Then there's the housing crisis and the high cost of living. So I'm going to speak of each of these in turn. So again, this is the report from OECD. And notice that if you are perceptive, this is figure 3 in the report. The previous one with the cookies was figure 1, okay, of the OECD. So this is another measure of income inequality. I like it less, okay, but nevertheless, this is the share of the top decile to the bottom decile in income distribution. So for example, if it were 10, it means that the upper decile, the upper 10% in terms of income of the households, they earn 10 times more on average than the lower decile. Okay? So you see that Israel is here. It doesn't look as bad, it's pretty bad. Okay? We don't want to be like you in the US. Okay, this is one measure that we don't want to be like the US. But I prefer the Gini, but I didn't have it there yet. So, this is the poverty rate. Now, this, try to look only at this for a moment. This is for Israel as a whole, okay, the whole country. This is the average poverty rate. Here it's below 18%. I haven't been able to check this number vis-a-vis the 19% I know, but doesn't matter much, you know, it's the highest. But look at this. This is Israel, non-Arabs, non-Haredi, non-ultra-Orthodox. Okay? So clearly there's a very strong sectorial component to poverty. It's focused, concentrated among the Israeli Arabs and among the ultra-Orthodox. And we are going to show you a graph that presents that explicitly.
How is this exactly calculated? I just don't understand from note two. I'm trying to figure out what that means exactly.
Again, it's a 50% of the median disposable income. The share of households is precisely the share of households, of total households, that which income is below 50% of the median average income of the households. It's important to remark on that because it's not individual incomes, it's households, etc., etc., adjusted for number of of adults, no, number of people in the house. Okay. Now, this there were several questions that pertain to this. You see, this is the share of working poor in Israel. These are people, households that are working, okay, and yet they are poor. Okay, so you can see now the little triangle there is 2012. And the red thing is 2016. So it means that the rate of the share of working poor has increased in Israel. Not only is high, but it has increased. Now that goes together with what also Yossi remarked, and there was another question. You see, if you have an increase in the participation, meaning more people are working, okay, but they're working part-time in jobs that don't pay very well, okay, you end up being still you're poor, but you're working. Okay? This is important because the government pursue a very aggressive policy of indeed encouraging labor force participation as a means to, as one of the means to combat poverty. Okay? And it has been only partially successful. Okay? Because you have indeed, many people working that remain poor. And there is another element that is dangerous here because it sends the wrong message. You know, what would you work, okay, if you remain poor and then you lose some of the benefits, etc. Okay, so this is an issue. The housing crisis. This is, if I have to single out one, I call it in a very bold way in Hebrew, it's an economic crime of the last decade is this. Okay, is the tremendous, continuous rise in the price of housing. Just to give you an idea, okay? A typical, an average price of a three-bedroom, small flat in Tel Aviv, it's about $800,000, okay? In Jerusalem, it less, it used to be the opposite. You need, in order to buy this apartment, nowadays, well, this is 2016, now it's worse. You need 13 years of average wages to be able to buy an apartment. In 2000 was 8, okay? This is disastrous for the typical family that I described before, that both, you know, the both in the couple, the women and the men work, they have children, they have many children, okay, 3.1 on average, and they cannot afford to buy an apartment. Now, you say, well, they could rent. Yes, but rents also rise, not at the same rate, among other things, because in Israel there's a strong bias towards purchasing, owning, and less towards renting. The rental market is not well developed. Only lately a law was passed trying to define better the property rights and so forth of the renting
tenant,
the tenants versus the owners and so forth, and this is an issue that has not been solved, developing the rental market. But this is really disastrous and has had a profound impact on social perceptions and the discontent and so forth. And let me say it very clearly. This is the fault of the government squarely without excuses. It's not the intifada, it's not the bubble, it's the bubble in the minds of governments, okay, that brought about this disaster. And I say it very strongly because, you know, some things are preventable, some things cannot be prevented but can be treated, and the government didn't prevent and didn't treat. And it's not just one government. Yes.
How could they prevent it? And isn't that influenced by a certain kind of aliyah, especially from what I hear from France, where people really buy apartments right, but don't really live in Israel?
Okay.
So they're not part of the economy.
That's right. So the issue of foreigners buying apartments became an issue, okay? But that can be easily dealt with. I mean, you know, the government lately raised the tax on owners of more than one apartment, okay, or more than two, actually.
Three.
No, this is that law didn't pass.
Okay.
There is the investors, not the other part. But in any case, this can be dealt with, and you could complain with taxes, okay, to do that. They didn't do it back then, okay. They did something, but not, they didn't go far enough in Singapore. You know, they had doubled the tax on foreigners purchasing real estate. Okay, you can deal with it if it becomes a national problem. But of course, the key is the increase in supply. The Israeli population is growing at the rate of almost 2% per year. So you know that why is the responsibility of the government? Because the government in Israel owns 95% of the land. And so, and it has control of the planning and so forth and so on. So they sit on the driver's seat in this market, okay? And they control the whole chain of taxation and so forth, and the local authorities have a great deal of control of zoning, but you can influence that if you wish, etc. Yes, yes.
I just want to add that the budget for housing by the government, for public housing.
Yeah.
Went down from the early 2000s from around 1% of GDP less than 0.5% of GDP. So at that time, they cut the budgets for public housing. It's mostly for the poor, but still, if you buy more houses for the poor, there'll be more housing for the others as well. Because, so it's also a budgetary issue.
Yeah.
You also have to factor in, you have to factor in the amount of money that's spent on housing in the territories.
We don't have good information on that.
No, I can answer that, but they
don't have accurate data on that.
Yeah, please.
Well, I guess it partially goes into my next question, because I was going to ask about across country. If I wanted to buy a house in the Golan or the Galil, which is not the most popular place to live, what would be the price differential as opposed to Tel Aviv or Yerushalayim?
Oh, much less. Yeah. There's a gradient. But that gradient in Israel, it's not terribly different from the gradient in New York State or whatever. But of course, like this, when you, you get away from the main, to the center of the metropolis. So it's not different. But the point is, you have to make sure that there's enough of a supply of housing where there is economic activity and people want to live. I mean, it's not just a matter of saying, hey, go live elsewhere. Okay, there is cheap. Yeah, what do you do? So,
my question was, if they own 95% of the land, they could build up those areas and create hubs in those areas. That was the implication. Not with...
They're trying.
I don't want to go too deep into this because we have a little time left and one third of the presentation. So, okay. But I would be happy to talk to you about these issues. So, and then there is the high cost of living, which I will not go into it much, but I will say the following. Israel, although it's tied with trade and everything with the rest of the world, but we're still in many ways an island. And I say an island because we have the sea on the one hand and enemies on the other side, so it's an island. And an island economy has issues when it's small with non-tradables, what we call, meaning that you easily can create pockets of monopoly power. Okay, and monopoly power may arise in many different ways. For example, it may arise because some monopolize imports of things that are not produced locally. Okay, so it's not necessarily local production, and so retail and so forth. So this has become a big issue, and there is progress in this area, actually, but it's slow, incremental. Okay, well, all that led to the big social protests in 2011, and I presume you are aware of that, so I'm not going to dwell on this too much. I headed the committee that was formed. There were far-reaching recommendations. I mean, really, a whole set of recommendations for the key issues. And some were implemented, but this is what really makes me very angry, because there is a whole chapter, four main chapters in the report. And the longest and more detailed was on housing, because this was the thing that was burning out there. And the government essentially didn't do anything. I mean, they did a couple of things. This is 2011, and we are still in the crisis. Okay, we are in 2008.
What's the politics of who are they catering to? I mean, presumably,
this is not the norm. I mean, Martin, policy is driven on the one hand by interests, and on the other hand by stupidity or incompetence.
It's a lot.
You can choose.
You can choose. Okay, but here it's not. I mean, I don't believe that they were serving any particular interest by not acting. The truth of the matter is that it is difficult, okay? But that only, it's difficult to really do what you have to do, okay? Because
but that's not the way of saying somebody could have got hurt.
Right. This is important to remark for two reasons. One is that this protest was the biggest, largest protest in Israel ever. We're 500,000 people on the streets, okay? This is 6% of the population. Think of what it means in other countries. And it was a peaceful protest, okay? And the government, in a way, reacted well in the sense of saying, okay, let's try to do something about it. And, there's a report. The government went through the ritual of adopting the report. And then some of it was implemented, particularly with regard to early childhood education. That was important. But, the worst was the crisis and the housing crisis. Okay. So let me go forward than really. So what accounts for both the good news and the bad news? So first of all, in terms of the good news, this is, I must say, you know, the economic profession, you know, has anything else, you know, a good side to it and a bad side to it. This is the good face of the economic profession. Because essentially the basic economic tenets and intuitions that were strongly, strongly embedded in the plan that was unveiled in 1985 and what has been going on since has pushed for these big things that are still with us. Okay, so the opening of the economy, this is an economy, although it was a market economy in principle, but it was highly centralized and it was relatively closed and with all sorts of measures and obstacles and so forth. And the government, together with the trade union main organization, the Istanbul, controlled a big chunk of the economy. And they started the process. What's so interesting about it is that, you see, 1985, okay, and there is a process that lasts to this day, okay, of systematic reforms, sector by sector, bringing more competition, outsourcing, privatizing, opening, liberalizing, removing barriers in an incredibly systematic way. I mean, there is a system in place that does that. It's pretty amazing to watch that, okay? The term reform has acquired almost mythical proportions in Israel. If you want to do anything, you have to say it's a reform. Otherwise, you know, you won't be able to do it. And when I added the higher education system, I needed desperately to increase the budget for higher education. So I presented a reform to the government.
What's the word in Hebrew?
Reform.
Reform.
Yeah. There are certain ways, you know, the lemon, banana, all these words are the same. So we squeeze the lemon, it's a reform. Anyway, so this has happened, and it's not the same. Strict fiscal discipline in spite of the politicians. This is not the politicians, okay? It's in spite. So how did it work? So, and then there is the startup nation. I will talk about that in a moment, but let's focus on this. So Israel had fiscal stability really in the middle of turbulence, both internal and external. So how can it be? Well, first of all, the difficulties. You know, we have coalition governments, but it's not just, you know, like in many countries in Europe, they have two parties, three parties. Okay. Oh, my God. No. In the present government, there are six different parties. Three or four of them they respond to special interests of sectors, well-defined sectors. Now, you have to understand, if you have a coalition member in the government and you represent a sector, you couldn't care less about fiscal responsibility. This is the least of your concerns. You want to increase the funds, the budgets to your sector. That's it. I mean, nothing else counts. Okay, and there are constant pressures to do that. We have a system, a political system, that is not so stable. I mean, we have elections on average every slightly more than 3 years. Okay, but the point is not if we knew for sure that the elections were every 3.3, that would be fine. Okay? I mean, nothing will happen to the US system of government if elections were held every 3 instead of every 4 years for the president, as long as it's certain. Mm-hmm. But there is high uncertainty. So what happens is that the ministers, they start to behave as the elections are around the corner 2 years into the term, sometimes before that. Okay? And that's the last thing you know you need for fiscal discipline. Okay? And then you have security shocks. Okay, which also impinge on the budget. So everything is essentially against you in terms of maintaining fiscal discipline. So how do you account for it? Well, first of all, the trauma of the hyperinflation, and what it did is they gave enormous power to the ministry, not the Minister of Finance, to the senior officers, in the Ministry of Finance. These are the most powerful people in the Middle East. I mean, and the thing is that who populates this budgeting division? Aha! These are young cadets. You know, they are the students of Yossi. They recruit them from the Hebrew University from a special program there. Okay? They become very idealistic, you know, driven, and they don't last. So they are always young. You need young people, you know, for this. I mean, I am serious, and this is amazing. You know, the average age there must be 35, or even less.
Yeah.
Perhaps less.
They don't last because they die on the job?
No. They don't last because they get, you see, jumping balls for... So they know that in a few years' time, they will get, they will be snatched, you know, by... to very good jobs, okay, they have to prove themselves, okay, it's male-dominated, now there are some women there, all the testosterone there is there, you know, they are going to show these ministers, okay, that they cannot spend your money, okay, and they do that with a vengeance,
yeah.
Okay? So this is amazing, because this is, you know, oftentimes we think in economics about models and, you know, This is the most effective. If I need to give advice to a country, I will recommend them how to recruit and train and socialize the budgeting division. That's it. Forget of everything else. Okay, that will do. I mean, with a higher probability than anything else. I mean, it's really stunning, you know, to see that. There are other things. You know, there are multiple layers of control. Opacity. We are all for, of course, the flow of information. Well, the Israeli budget is very opaque. There are big things there that only these young guys know about. The minister doesn't have any idea. Now, I know quite a bit of it for other reasons. Let me tell you that the gap in information between the minister and the real thing in the budget is stunning. Okay? And this is one of the reasons why the budget can absorb shocks, like security shocks, without the debt, because there are hidden reserves there and so forth and so on. And when I was candidate for finance minister, I said to you, you know, I wish I didn't know. It's better not to know that you are a minister. And then there are fiscal rules. We don't have time to do it. This is very interesting. I personally, I'm responsible for some of this, and this has become an issue, and it's a very interesting thing to discuss. Okay? So there is no time. So let me just jump into the I'm sorry about this, I mean, we're running out of time.
Don't go until 1:30, but it will take some extra time.
Okay, so a few words about the Startup Nation. This is a topic in itself. I don't want to, you know it, you know, we have time for the Startup Nation. Great, you know, good luck. I want to remark. So, in terms of R&D, we are the spend the most in terms relative to GDP. Sometimes last year Korea was ahead, now we are ahead. Okay, this is interesting. You know, the listing of high tech companies in Nasdaq. So we have 67. This is, by the way, it's not the latest figure. So it's higher now. Probably maybe you know, Gadi. What's the latest? But I want to compare it to Europe.
Yeah.
The entire Europe has 84 companies listed in us. We have 67. So this says something about our presence in the high-tech world. Okay? But I want to remark this. One of the drivers of this entrepreneurship, this extraordinary explosion of entrepreneurship, is the fact that we have a young population. Okay? Typically, inventors, innovators are young. There are some exceptions, and some of them are here. but you know, but typically, you know, that's the case. Now, this number again, the highest in the OECD. I already talked about the fertility, young age, the percentage of young population, the highest in the OECD. Okay, so we have a reservoir there of young people coming up. Okay. And this plays a significant role. Now, this should be investigated. Again, I'm saying that, I'm not saying this is an academic fact. I'm saying this is a fact that needs to be studied in terms of how much this has contributed. Okay.
The fertility rate is particularly a puzzle. opportunity cost of women having children must be very, very high.
I talked about that before you came.
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
But
so,
we can discuss it later
yeah,
on. I mean, it's a
yeah.
topic that really occupies me a lot. Now, what accounts for the
country? We are a country in war. There is
what?
A risk that they will die, so they make more children.
Come on.
No,
I don't agree.
It is a social attitude.
Yeah,
yeah, sure.
I don't think it has to do with
why does it occur?
No, well, I don't know. That's a speculation, but you know.
No, but you don't have the classic 50% mortality rate of children
got
to the age of five.
Yeah.
That,
so let's talk about that later. So the bad news. Okay, how can we have poverty and so forth and so on? So first of all, and I talked about that the other day, we are extremely heterogeneous. Okay. And that, of course, impinges on poverty and inequality and so forth. This is sort of the great diversity of Israeli society. The point I mentioned the other day, there is no majority. Okay? There are only minorities. Okay? But this is more important. Okay, look at the employment rates, women. Okay? Arab women, very low rate of participation. It's going up slowly. Compare it up there. This is what I mentioned before, increased participation of women in the labor force. Stunning, okay, with ultra-orthodox women. Men, the opposite, right? Arabs are doing quite well and catching up. Okay, ultra-orthodox, the level is very low, catching up a little bit. Poverty, okay, you can see. Now, this is not the most updated data, but it doesn't matter, it looks like this. Think of 50% poverty rates among the Arabs and the ultra-Orthodox, much lower among the Arabs. So clearly, this is a big source of what we saw before in the aggregate, okay? But what I want to really put the emphasis is on this point, that the same factors that account for the great success at the macro level also have some responsibility for the flip side of it, which is the social failures of the nation, okay? So we had, the strictures of fiscal policy became a dogma. It's not that every year or every 2 years there will be sort of a revision, let's think it over and see whether we have gone too far. No. You keep going like a locomotive, okay, without the driver, okay? That's what happened, okay? And essentially, you know, there was a policy that had many levels. One is a reduction in the share of social spending relative to GDP, and at the same time, a reduction of taxes. And the reduction of taxes became sort of a roadmap that you had to follow, okay, regardless. And of course, the conception was you starve the beast. Okay, you lower taxes, this we know from the Reagan era, and so forth, you know, and it keeps coming back in the US. Yes.
But maybe this is because the young people who are in charge that you just talked about don't stay very long, so they don't see the results of their dogma.
That's in part true, but you know the thing is that these young guys, okay, they shouldn't run the show at the upper level. I mean, for this you have prime ministers and you have a Knesset and so forth, and there hasn't been a change, a major revision of fiscal policy in Israel for a long time. Okay, so you can guess.
So you're bringing up Israel-specific reasons, but at the same period, we see the skill premium going up, also in the U.S.
Right.
And Israel being so much, so many people, high-tech, that I think can kind of help explain this, the inequality that has happened. That goes together with the theory you showed us of top decile versus bottom
decile.
That's true.
So the inequality part is partly explained by that. But let me show you this, okay? This is the government spending as a percentage of GDP. Okay, we were very high, okay, certainly. Okay, we had to come down. We went down to, this, by the way, is lower now. It's a bit less than 40%. Okay, we'll show you a comparison in a moment. The tax burden went down. Family benefits, as a, again, spending as a percentage of GDP.
Just on the first row. I feel like that first row is actually what Gideon just said.
I will escape that. At the same time, okay, the average for the OECD went the other way around. Okay? Now, there is on the one hand the issue of inequality, And there is the issue of the provision of social services like education, health, and so forth. Okay? What I'm talking about is the provision of services. Okay? The way that inequality enters as a result is because if what you do is the following, and follow me for a moment, you reduce the marginal rate of taxation. Okay? So the system becomes less progressive. At the same time, because you have reduced taxation, you reduce social spending on health and education. Okay? The result of that is you pass the burden on the expenditures on education and health on the housing. The two things lead to more inequality. But if the second part of what I said doesn't show up in the Gini, because it's inequality, you see, it's inequality de facto, okay, because I have to pay more now for something that previously the government was supplying. For example, okay, the government is supplying less health coverage, not coverage, but if you want to have your CT done in time, you have to pay in order to shorten the waiting time, okay? Before that, that didn't happen. So the effective cost for you has gone up. Okay, that increases de facto inequality.
I think social spending goes, I mean, that's kind of very important for the low decile. And the 2011 was a very middle income protest, so, I mean.
No, the West middle class is true, but they were pushing for more, the government taking more responsibility over education, over housing, and so forth. So although it was driven by the middle class, but the issues they raised were had wider social significance.
But they were talking a lot about prices, right? Like wages, real wages and prices also not going to the direction of increasing inequality, like slower increase in real wage as opposed to price level in the economy.
No, that's right. I mean, there were many things happening at the same time. Now I'm focusing on what you see. One of the things that happened to me, for better or for worse, is that I tend to put emphasis on the levers of policy.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Because in the end, I want to do something about it, or I want to influence those doing something about it. Okay? And so that's my emphasis. But you're right. I mean, you know, it's a complex picture. Okay? Sort of.
Social policies like patches for education and social assistance, but not, I mean, maybe not enough to push on the regulatory part of
to what?
Regulation or over monopolies or.
Actually, that part, you see, interestingly enough, you ask, there's a chapter in the report on that, okay? And interestingly enough, that has been partially implemented or incrementally is being implemented since.
Mm-hmm.
The antitrust authority has greatly strengthened its authority, personnel, et cetera, following the report. And they are active more and more sectors. Okay, push for them to take a proactive attitude and not a passive one, not if you complain about the cartel or monopoly, but rather go and single out sectors that you know that there are problems there, or you should know. Okay, and go for it, okay? The dismantling all sorts of regulations that were, to give you an example, one of the things that we pushed for and what did happen is it's a tax break for buying online, okay, up to a certain amount. Now, that was traumatic in Israel because, again, we are an island, so it's not that it could go from Switzerland to France to buy, you know, something cheaper. But you can buy online, wow, that puts a lot of pressure on local prices. People have been complaining about the retail sector, have been complaining a lot about that. But you see, all these measures kind of bring more lower prices through pro-competitive measures. Okay, so there is a lot of that actually happening. Not enough, a long way to go on that. Okay? So this is primary civilian expenditure, we are here, and so forth. But it doesn't stop there, you know, the reasons for the problem. Essentially, in Israel, you see, there is this funny situation where the prime minister is essentially, first and foremost, the prime minister for what we call security and foreign affairs. That's what consumes, if you look at the schedule, okay, of meetings with the prime minister, done that for over 3 years, it's amazing, I mean, how much of his time is occupied by not purely social issues. This is very different from other countries, from most other countries, where the prime concern of the prime minister is balancing out between the different ministers and different that and the social issues and so forth. Not in Israel. They appear to the prime minister when there's a crisis. There are many crises. But only when the situation is sufficiently, you know, problematic over the time of the budget, but not otherwise. And therefore, the minister or the Minister of Finance acquires a lot of power. But the mandate of the Minister of Finance is first and foremost that, right, the budget, okay? So, in this sense, you see that what the social part of the equation is missing there. I mean, there is no central figure in government that has the power and the authority to set a social agenda vis-a-vis the agenda of the Ministry of Finance. Okay, and this is, again, something that we economists don't pay attention to typically. It's an institutional factor that may go a long way in explaining these things. Lack of investment in infrastructure, public transportation is a disaster. And this is something that I pay a lot of attention. And it has profound social consequences because people that cannot afford housing in the center, near where the action is, they won't be able to earn higher salaries and so forth and so on. And it's bad for the economy because you have a misallocation of the most important resource, the labor, you know, across occupations because of lack of transportation and the housing situation. Well, I said that about failure, you know, I can go on and on with that. And then this. Yes, we proud ourselves of having this type of nation, it's true. Except that those that benefit from the high tech sector in Israel are very few. It's essentially around 8% of employment, and among the 8%, everybody that works in the high tech sector is relatively well paid, but you have the, mm-hmm. you know, the pay there, and you have. So, this is an example, another one, of that trickle down doesn't really work. Mm-hmm. Okay, because we had that for a long time. And one of the. So, anyway, so can it be different? Yes, indeed, it can be different. You know, we need to do a bunch of other things. You know, balance socioeconomic policies. Yes, fiscal responsibility. You know, the way I speak may sound as if I'm a very activist, kind of a deficit prone guy. And you couldn't be more wrong than that. And Yossi will attest to that because he was on the other side of the trenches, actually criticizing me for good reason because I was too conservative from the fiscal point of view. I still am. But that doesn't contradict, you know, having sound social policies. We need to essentially make innovation the main thing, not only in high tech. I mean, there's a very narrow view of what innovation is in this sector. Mm-hmm. And many sectors in the economy, particularly services, okay, are not innovative. Education policies, I strongly believe in that. I strongly believe in early age. Every child in education as a great equalizer, and in providing skills for those that don't go to academia. Okay, that's key. And we need to understand that we live in a society that is very heterogeneous, as I said, and therefore we need to tailor. There's no such thing as a policy that is one size fits all. Okay, in any real means, you need to be very mindful of that, because you may do something that's good for Tel Aviv and doesn't work for the Israeli arts and so forth. So it has to be an integral part of the policies. And yet, you know, we are a surprisingly content bunch. And this is kind of very interesting, I find it. So subjective well-being, personal security. Okay, we are here. Here is the OECD. Okay, health status, of course. You know, Israel has one of the highest ranks, one of the highest countries in terms of what's called HAIL, HALE, health adjusted life expectancy. Okay? So, you know, but on the other hand, work-life balance. I said before, you know, the two members of the couple work hard, they have many children, and we are, you know, out of breath.
Okay. No, that's good. Sorry.
So the axes. So the way this
the work-life balance is way off to the right.
The way it works is,
that's
if you're good. Outside, you're better off. You're inside, you're worse off. Mm-hmm. Okay? So the red line is Israel.
Oh, I see.
And the other one is the average for the OECD. So in terms of subjective well-being, we're much better. In terms of personal security, we're better, slightly better. In terms of health status, much better. In terms of work-life balance, worse. Okay? And that's, of course, housing. Okay, so there are no surprises here.
There's an issue on the environmental.
Yes, quality. Environmental quality, I don't know exactly why, because it's not that the situation until now is that bad, but it's getting worse because of congestion, because of the the density and so forth. So in the main urban centers, you know, with the traffic problems and so forth, you have an increasingly bad environment.
That's interesting about social connection.
Yes.
There are so many social connections.
That's right. Yes. I don't understand that. And this is something that's been puzzling me a lot. Mm-hmm. And I want to look further into that because it doesn't sit well with the perceptions. Absolutely. You're absolutely right.
Isn't it surprising that jobs and earnings almost overlapping? Israel and
jobs and earnings. I said we have the lowest, a very low rate of unemployment, a very high rate of labor force participation. So you see, in terms of jobs, getting jobs, we are in a fantastic time. In terms of earnings, much lesser. But you have to disentangle the two so that you will see earnings on the one side and jobs on the other side will be different stories.
But what does the line of...
Is it based on a survey?
This is what the OECD does. I mean, it's
I didn't translate the survey well.
No. This is the... this
but
is
well, where, does, this is where does the annual finding on the level of poverty that are...
No, poverty is not here. No, but that, you know, that's a different, but this is a better life index, it's called. The OECD, let me say the following, which is an interesting thing. In economics, we deal mostly with GDP, and GDP per capita, okay? In the last decade, there has been a gradual movement towards expanding the criteria by which we judge countries, economies, and so forth. There is the Human Development Index of the UN, which essentially is a combination of GDP, health, and education. Okay? There is the Better Index, Life Index of the OECD, that they are expanding and working it a lot, that includes all these things. There is the Happiness Index, again, that's a bit, and so forth and so on. So this is a big movement, which I absolutely agree with, of taking many more criteria and not just GDP exclusively, to judge, essentially as a means of judging overall performance of the country or society. Okay, let me just conclude with the following observation. I hope I managed to convince you one thing, that Israel is an interesting case, Istanbul. Because it has these remarkable features that for better and for worse. You see, and we need laboratory cases like that. I mean, it flashes out, you know, trade-offs and so forth and so on. We are not a case of bad policies and that's it. No. This is a case of very good policies go away. I mean, out of control. Okay? That brought the bad side of it as well. Okay? And things like that. We have, in our history, cases of ridiculous economics, okay, that brought disaster, and very sound economic thinking, okay? So what I'm saying is that, I don't And the other thing that is very peculiar to Israel is the heterogeneity. Whenever people tell me, well, you know, we should adopt the Nordic model, I say, no problem. Whenever we all become, sorry about that, whenever we become blonde with blue eyes, all of us, we'll do it right away. Okay? There is an excellent paper by Alessina and others showing how heterogeneity in the population pinches on the social, on spending, on government spending. Okay? If there is a diverse population, you're very reluctant to put your dollar, your tax dollars into something else benefit. Okay? And so forth. So you see, in the end, okay, policies are the result of a conjunction of a bunch of factors. Okay? Economic thinking, the politics, the composition of the population, the constraints, and so forth. And I think that Israel is a very interesting case of all that. And the last point is that economics have done a lot of good to Israel. Economic thinking. Also, some bad. And we need much more of that. We need to deploy our academic capabilities. I said that before and we keep saying that. Okay? For the benefit of our societies, we cannot remain detached. Okay? These are real things that affect many, many people. That's it. Thank you very much.